Thank you for joining this reflection on the momentous events of the first Good Friday. In this hour, we will follow the story of Christ's passion and death on the cross through Bible readings and prayers, interspersed with music to aid our reflection and meditation. And in this strange world of lockdown and isolation, I think we're into our third week already, I'm reminded of the story of Robinson Crusoe, and it made me think, you know, if a Christian was put onto a deserted island and had to forage for his or herself, what would be the first thing they want? And the answer for me is a cross. I would go and find some sticks and tie them together to make a cross. And as you can see, that's what I've done. This is my COVID cross. It's very rough, but I think it's beautiful. And for me, it will be a reminder of the great lockdown of 2020. So it won't be perhaps a family heirloom, but I'm very proud of it and happy to have it in this service today. And first, a prayer for forgiveness. Father, we have sinned against heaven and against you. We are not worthy to be called your children. We turn to you again. Have mercy on us. Bring us back to yourself as those who once were dead but now have life, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We don't have a choir, there are only two of us here, but we do have a recorded hymn, and we hope you'll join in.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong
Christ my Savior and
consider the crucifixion, there is one character who is briefly mentioned and then disappears from the Bible. We never hear of him again. In fact, most of us only mention his name on Good Friday. And you know, we all know somebody who's got a biblical name, don't we? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Peter, Paul, Samuel, Jacob, Ezra, Ruth, Mary, Naomi, to mention a few. But how many people do you know called Barabbas? No, neither do I. But what do we know of Barabbas? Well, he was found guilty of insurrection. That was a serious crime because the Romans would put you to death for insurrection. So he was under a death sentence, but he was also under a death sentence for committing robbery with violence and murder. So all in all, he was a bad lot, a hardened criminal. And we can imagine him on the day of his execution, the day jailer comes and unlocks the door for him and they drag him out of his cell, and then the jailer says, well, you can go free. Well, maybe they stood him on the balcony with Pilate in the middle, Jesus on one side and Barabbas on the other, facing the crowd, and let's see who they shout for. And he would be thinking, wouldn't he? Well, there's no way they're going to choose me to set me free. And wonder what happened to him after his release. Did he go back to his old mates and start a new crime wave? Or did he become a reformed person, thanking God for his new chance of going straight in a new life? We shall never know. And yet, he is central to the crucifixion story. Because when Jesus took the place of Barabbas, he took our place too. He rescued us all. We are the redeemed people of God, rescued by the blood of Christ on Calvary. And today we stand before the cross, our heads bowed, seeing his blood running into the earth. Dare we raise our eyes to see the suffering in his face that he endures for our sake, so that we can become children of God, and so that we can inherit a new life which begins here on earth with Jesus and endures beyond death into eternity.
This Good Friday, we join our voices to the words of Jesus on the cross and the cry of all who are abandoned. My God, why have you forsaken me? We stand alongside this ancient cry of dereliction and place ourselves with all those who cry out for food and justice, for work and healing, for hope and love, for faith and for meaning. We hear their pain and the pain of Jesus Christ. God of compassion, we pray for our world, laid low by the scourge of COVID-19. We pray for our own nation and ask you to be close to those who are ill, afraid, or in isolation. In their loneliness, be their consolation. In their anxiety, be their hope. In their darkness, be their light. And in their sorrow and mourning, be their comfort. We give thanks that during this epidemic, the homeless are being brought in, that neighbours are caring for each other, that young people have responded to the call to help supply the needs of the elderly, that families and friends are calling each other regularly, dispelling loneliness and fear. We give thanks for the selfless acts of courage and bravery of NHS staff, for the doctors and nurses who have come out of retirement to place themselves in harm's way for the common good. For the contribution of our uniformed emergency services and the armed forces, for the factories and workshops turning out vital equipment and supplies, for the calming and inspiring message of Her Majesty the Queen. And Lord, we do not forget other people across the world whose precarious and fragile existence is now impacted by this terrible pandemic. Those forced to endure an existence in the squalor of refugee camps, facing the bleakest future imaginable. We give thanks for all who work to alleviate suffering all over the world. And now, standing at the foot of the cross, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son and make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulder. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me to life. I know that it is finished.
My ransom. Why should I gain from his Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had assembled. But Peter followed him at a distance, right up to the courtyard of the high priest. He entered and sat down with the guards to see the outcome. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for false evidence against Jesus so they could put him to death. But they did not find any, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward and declared, "This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and rebuild it in 3 days.'" Then the high priest stood up and said to Jesus, "Are you going to answer? What is this testimony these men are bringing against you?" But Jesus remained silent. The high priest said to him, "I charge you under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God." "Yes, it is as you say," Jesus replied. "But I say to all of you, in the future you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the cloud of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, now you have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" "He is worthy of death," they answered. Then they spat in his face and struck him with their fists. Others slapped him and said, "Prophesy to us, Christ. Who hit you?"
Thank you.
Now Peter was sitting out in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him. "You were with Jesus of Galilee," she said. But he denied it before them all. "I don't know what you are talking about," he said. Then he went out to the gateway, where another girl saw him, and said to the people there, "This fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth." He denied it again, with an oath, "I don't know the man." After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, "Surely you are one of them. Your accent gives you away." Then he began to call down curses on himself, and he swore to them, "I don't know the man." Immediately a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." And he went outside and wept bitterly.
Believe me.
your soul.